Namaskaram Andy. Welcome to NRI Guest with Prakash Kapila. Today we have very distinguished guests like Stephen Rogers and Hemant Bhatt. We are going to discuss different details about the US policy on immigration, North Korea, China, and Iran, as well as DALCA and immigration, to be precise, and look forward to have more feedback from you guys.
So today we have two important guests with us. One is Stephen Rogers, who is sitting on my right, and then Hemant Bhatji. So before delving into
the details, these both accomplished people have consented to talk about how Trump is making America great again, and how, from where, as soon as he took office, from where he has come from, and how he's taking America into a very good future. And we are also going to talk about Iran deal, we are going to talk about North Korea, we are going to talk about the recent things. But before that, I want them to introduce themselves so that my experience is not enough to describe about them. So I would like them to describe themselves, and we can kick off the show. Sir Rogers, please.
Well, thank you. First of all, it's a pleasure being here. The hospitality has been terrific. Well, to begin with, I am a member of President Donald Trump's campaign advisory board. Obviously, he has a re-election coming up in 2020, so we've been out working very hard to get the grassroots people in this country back together to ensure that the president is re-elected. Secondly, I spent 38 years of my life on the Nutley, New Jersey Police Department, retired as a Detective Bureau Commander. So I know a lot about law enforcement and a lot about the criminal justice system. And in addition to that, I served in the United States Navy, retired as a lieutenant commander, senior military intelligence officer who was assigned to the FBI National Joint Terrorism Task Force. So I'm well versed in homeland security, national security, foreign affairs, but I've got to tell you, working with the president's campaign has been quite a journey, and a very good journey.
Awesome. So how did your journey start? Like, if you could throw more light on how it all started for you, say from 20 years on.
From 20 years on, wow, you're going way back. Well, you know, I believe in God. I believe in the power of prayer. When I became a police officer, I did a lot of praying. It was a tough job. Mm. And I've always asked the good Lord, I said, you know what? Use me. Just use me to help people. Use me in a way that I could contribute to people from all walks of life. God gives us all talents and skills, right? He gives us gifts. One could be a musician, another could be an artist. He's given me the ability to communicate and to organize. And as a result, I've prayed, said, Lord, you just use this talent. And a man once said to me, he said, "There's in our Christian Bible, there's a scripture that says, be willing and obedient. So maybe I wasn't willing a lot of times, but I certainly was obedient. And that was the beginning of my journey, just depending on God and prayer. And look, I mess up like a lot of people. I'm no angel. But I know right from wrong. And I know when I do things I shouldn't be doing, he kind of slaps me around a little bit and straightens me out. But overall, he's blessed me. He's kept his word. So that was the beginning of my journey many, many years ago.
Awesome. Hemant Bhatji, yeah. Please tell about yourself, how you have, what your journey is, how you travel. Because a lot of our viewers are young viewers. We want them to learn from you guys. So therefore, right. I've been pushing you guys for.
That's excellent. So basically, I landed in this country in 2001, June 1st to be exact. And I was like other immigrants who have come here. I was lawyer back home. I practiced law there. I was a company secretary and general manager of finance with the Videocon group of companies.
Awesome.
Which is one of the largest corporations, yes, in India. So we worked at the top corporate levels. And when I came here, it was altogether a new life, and everything was like, I was finding everything new, everything different than what we have back home. And it was quite challenging to me. And as Stephen said, I believe in God, and I trust him. Whatever I'm today because of him. That is 100% true. And I started my journey here with my wife, and I have one son, one daughter, and of course now I have two granddaughters and one grandson. And back in 2000, I think I became citizen of US in 2006. And at that time, I was not very much aware about the political stuff in America. Mm-hmm. I was back home, I was very much active in political stuff. Like I was a secretary of the economic policy cell of government of Gujarat. From the Congress party. And then here, I was first of all trying to settle myself and then started taking interest in the mainstream America life. 2006, I became a citizen. And you know the entire process, you have to pass 4.5 years without doing any crime, without doing any kind of thing. You have to apply to the government, and then after making an application, you have to pay the fees. After paying the fees, they take the fingerprints. But I'm telling you this, I will give you the reference later on. Mm-hmm. We have to have a fingerprints, and then there's an interview. We have to take an oath that I am committed to the United States Constitution.
That's true.
And then I started looking for, as most of our Indian people, when they come here, Indian South Asian people, back home we are very conservative people. I think we cannot think the way the liberals are thinking. And I was not aware about the difference between the liberal people and the Republican people, the conservative people. And I came to know everything once I started leaning into the main life. And then I registered myself as a Democrat to begin with. Mm-hmm. At that time, I was not aware, because India, there is a democracy. And I thought America is a democratic party. That party is my party. And that is a misunderstanding with most of us in here. And when I started, Donald Trump, let me go a little further. He announced his candidacy as a candidate for the president of USA. And at that time, I started thinking about Republican, because I know that he is a Republican. He's being nominated. I mean, he's being contesting from the Republican Party line ticket. Mm-hmm. I researched for the Republican Party, and I thought that this is the party where I belongs to. This is the place where I should be. So I registered myself as a Republican man. And from that day one, I was doing everything possible, whatever base for this country. This is a beautiful country, ample opportunities for the people like us. We must make use of it. And we have to understand very well that we are here to support, help this country. We are not here to damage this country.
Mm-hmm. You know, Hammett just articulated something very interesting. He is successful, as I've learned recently, that the Indian Americans in this country are overwhelmingly successful. And you just told the audience, you just told me a lot of young people are watching.
Yes.
So I'm going to look. Can I look into that camera and talk to those young people?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
Yes.
What you see here is the embodiment of a man who took to heart the principles of the founding fathers of the United States of America. And he probably didn't know that until now.
Yes.
But he talked to the, and I talked to the young people about this. The Indian Americans in this country have contributed so much, and we're going to be talking about that,
yes,
I know.
Yes.
But because your culture and your families, you believe in duty, honor, country, but first God and second family. So as young people, you stick to that. Those are the principles that you've talked about.
Absolutely.
Those conservative principles. You stick to that, and you're going to go far. And that's the reason why that Indian American young people in this country are beginning to own a lot of countries. They're beginning to spur a spirit of entrepreneurship unlike anything we've seen in many, many years. And I had the opportunity to speak to some young people at this wonderful temple we were at, right?
Robbinsville, New Jersey.
So my point is this. Young people need to know that there is a pathway to success. And the pathway isn't politics. The pathway isn't a lot of the things that we see on television or here on radio, but the pathway is God, family, duty, honor, and country. That's the pathway to success.
Excellent.
And you just explained it.
Yes, sir. That is the reason why I always like to, whenever I spread my message, I'm very much active on social media and other things. I'm trying to spread the message that we are religious people, we are conservative people, We are culturally very rich people, And we have to not only maintain our civilization and culture in this country, but at the same time, we should match ourselves with the mainstream America, which is also the same thing what we belong to.
Yes, which, yes. Which, by the way, I had a discussion with someone mm-hmm. here before we came on the air. The mainstream media, the liberals, the progressives, they talk about polls. They go out and they say, well, the polls say that President Trump's popularity is down. The polls say conservatism is down, and on and on and on. So how do you think the president became successful? He forgot polls, disregarded polls, and he went not into the pocketbooks of the people, but he went into the pulse
hearts,
of the people,
yes, heart.
The heart, the soul, the spirit. This is why we have a president, unlike any other president, at least in my lifetime, gone out and reached out into the inner cities. He's reached out to communities that represent diverse cultures from all over the country. So we have a president who has taken the lead on inviting everyone, inviting everyone into this camp, mm-hmm. And it's inviting everyone to the team, to Team Trump. So this is the success of this president. And boy, I'll tell you, right, Hammett, it is spreading. And,
yes.
and that's why we now have the America Winning Coalition.
Absolutely,
spreading.
Absolutely.
So in the interest of time, we'll move into very few topics that we have selected. So first and foremost comes immigration. So there is a lot of talk in the progressive and liberal media that Trump is against immigration. So I leave it to Rogers to defund that.
President Trump is opposed to illegal immigration, and he's absolutely 1,000,000% in favor of legal immigration. My wife is an immigrant. She is from Russia. She lived under the hammer and sickle.
Right.
She left that country when perestroika came. She came here as a legal immigrant. And when you were telling your story about the fingerprints and the pictures, and you had to take a test and swear to the Constitution, one of the most proudest moments of my life was to be in Newark, New Jersey, and see over 100 people like my wife raising their right hand and doing it legally the right way. So let's be clear that the President of the United States is all for legal immigrants opposed to illegal immigrants.
Right.
And it is the legal immigrants. You know, you hear about, well, we need the immigrants here to work the fields, the farms. Nonsense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It is, you want to see what legal immigrants do, point to the Indian American community. Look at the entrepreneurs. Look at the startup businesses. Your success is based on a legal foundation. So he's in favor of legal immigration.
Right. I will also add one point here, what Stephen said. See, legal immigrants, and the Mr. Trump is also in favor of the skilled immigrants. He's also in favor of the people who really come here. See, he wants that the system should not be burdened by illegal people in this country, which will be detrimental to the interest of the people who are living legally here. And number two is, I always think that illegal immigrants are unfair to the legal immigrant people, because when I passed through all kind of situations, I did everything possible to become legal in this country, and someone come here in the country by crossing the border, or they are overstaying.
Well, let me give you an example about that border and the controversy over the wall. I worked with military intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
After 9/11, many people were crossing that Mexican border. We didn't know who they were. We were in great fear and very concerned who was crossing that border. Were they terrorists? Were they drug smugglers? Were they human traffickers? It ends up that many of them were. So the president has made it clear, the wall's going up, we're strengthening our border to ensure that that element does not come in. He's not against all Mexicans. He's a father, he has children,
absolutely.
He loves kids. He don't want to see families broken up, but he doesn't want to see the United States of America broken up over bad policies.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why it's important for the people, not only here in America, but around the world, they get the facts.
And see, the security of the safety and security of the people, American people, is also very important. Whenever anybody, like, as for example, Mr. Trump has imposed the ban over the people coming from the Muslim countries, which are considered as a home of terrorism. Now, we don't know whom we are accepting here and refusing. We don't have gone to their background checks and everything. Somebody comes here and if they put the life of our Americans in danger, this is not good. So I really admire Mr. President's immigration policies. This is going to work in a beautiful way in time to come. And the same people who are opposing this policy are going to come to the agreement with Mr. Trump that yes, that president has done the right thing for this country.
Yeah, one thing about the immigration is every country sets the rules of whom has to come in and be part of their daily life, whether it's India, whether it's Europe, every European country have got their own rules and regulations. So America having its own rules is good for America, is good for not only America, but for the immigrants who are coming. Because if you are not able to be in line with what is required, then you will feel out of the place and it will be difficult for you. So in that process, in the same immigration thing, what is happening is most of the Indian skilled immigration, they are waiting for that green card process for like 15 years, 20 years, and it seems like an endless journey.
Yes.
And for America, this is very bad. Why is it bad? Because those people who are waiting in the queue, they don't know theoretically what their future will be like. So they don't have the, they are in an insecure feeling that if I invest in a home or if I buy something, or if I buy a good car or buy a good home, then maybe, there is some uncertainty.
Sure.
And uncertainty is bad for the markets. It's bad for the economy as well. So a lot of these people who are in the queue for 15 years and counting, what would be your advice to the president to push the things? Because these guys are very skilled.
Yes.
And if you give them the opportunity, they will create a lot of businesses. America is losing a lot of talent because these people are in a queue and they can't go out and start their own business, start up a subway, whatever.
Let me share with those in the queue some light at the end of this tunnel. The president has consistently said that he wants people coming to this country, legal immigrants coming who have skills, who have talents, who can contribute to the American economy, contribute to national security. And he is very well aware that India is one of those great countries of the world with many, many talented people. That's number one. Number two, the mess that we're in today, the immigration policies, are those that have been neglected for many, many years by prior administrations.
Absolutely.
He has consistently told Congress to fix the problem.
Yes.
It's going to take Congress to fix this problem. And knowing the way he is, if they don't fix it, he'll find a way to fix it.
Yeah.
He will. He will. And I always measure a man's ability to move forward by his track record. So let's look at the president's track record. And this is for those in the queue that have been waiting. Number one, every promise he made, he's kept. Everyone.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
At least tried to.
I'm going to qualify that statement, all right?
Yeah.
Every promise he's made, he's kept. Except when it came to his needing assistance from Congress, from senators, they let him down. They let us down. They let everybody down. So the problem is on them, not on him.
Right. Healthcare bill, for example.
Healthcare bill, exactly. But saying that, he is determined to fix these problems because he is well aware, and you nailed it. You said the right thing. There is so much that can be contributed to this country, the economy. Look at the houses that can be bought, business and industries. So I would say this, that there is light at the end of the tunnel. We have a president who has a Herculean big job ahead of him to fix this. But I have a lot of optimism that he will. Mm-hmm. And I always go back to this. I say, look, people ask me, like I'm sure those in the queue, how can I help? How can I help? I'm trying to get there.
Yeah.
This is one we fall back on to what the president and his wife said to a group of us who were in the White House in December. He comes out with his wife, stands by a podium, we're waiting for the speech to start, and he says, before we do anything in this house, we're going to bow our heads and we're going to pray, because there is a God who guides us, who protects us, and he still is in the business of answering prayers. So I tell people all over, best way to help him when you're not here, pray for the good Lord to guide him and to give him the tools he needs to fix the problem. That's how we do it. That should be encouraging to everyone listening tonight.
And he is very right. The problem of the immigration policy is like a federal subject, and the immigration policy has to be fixed, but the law has to be fixed by the Congress, by the Senate. Yes. President alone cannot do anything.
He has a bully pulpit that he can.
He has. Yeah. But I will add this, and you just said it. Every person who is of Indian descent in this country, they should be calling their congressmen. Mm-hmm. They should be calling their congresswomen. They should be putting the heat on them so badly that they will have no choice but to act on it. I've learned one thing about politicians. You can have rallies, you can have all kinds of things, but boy, once you start threatening them with regard to you're going to lose your job, because we're going to get, in this case, maybe a few thousand people of Indian ancestry in this country, in your district, we're going to throw you out of office, and we're going to put someone in there who's going to support the president. That's how it works. Mm-hmm. You go after the thing they cherish, and that is the office they hold.
Yes, yes. So the most important thing in this skilled immigration is, if you look at the history of the world, say around 1990s, Japan was going leaps and bounds, and it was the number two. And soon it was supposed to overthrow America in terms of economic progress. And suddenly it stopped the immigration. So from 1985 onwards, it stopped immigration. And now they don't have workers.
Right.
In just 15 years, the whole table turned around. And the skill, with the lack of skilled people, they are now opening up their borders. They're opening up to the skilled engineer, because it takes 20 years to make an engineer.
Keep in mind this. President Trump is not a politician. He is a businessman.
Right.
He is a builder. He doesn't tear things down, he builds things up.
Yeah. Yeah.
He also doesn't divide, he unites.
Right.
So as a businessman, as a person who puts politics in the back seat and business smarts in the front seat, what you just said, he knows, he's aware of. And
Thank you. And
there's an old saying, if you don't learn from history, history is bound to repeat itself. I can tell you, with this president in office, we're not going to allow history to repeat itself as what happened in Japan, as you just described, here in this country. That's why I say there's a lot of light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, not everyone gets a chance to hear that light on the mainstream media here in America. They're the darkest, darkest, saddest bunch of people I've ever seen.
And see, important thing is, this problem is not today's problem.
Exactly.
Mr. Trump is not responsible for it.
Of course, of course.
This problem has been dragged from the previous administrations and previous administrations like that.
Agreed, agreed.
And in this situation, I think, this is, as you very rightly said, that he is a very optimistic guy. He builds the thing. He builds the nation. He build. See his history, track record. The day on which he is elected as a president of this country, look at the stock market, look at the economy, look at the gross domestic product, look at the unemployment numbers which we are having today.
And part of that, the CEO of Google is of
Sundar
Indian
Pichai.
The CEO of Microsoft.
Pepsi.
And let's add a little bit icing on the cake. Right? You out there listening, especially for young people, let's put some icing on the cake. Nikki Haley, our ambassador, is of Indian ancestry.
Absolutely.
So when you look at the contribution of one country, India, all right, think about that. So the president, I'm sure, is thinking, you know what, look at the contributions we have. Why would we want to close borders, make it hard for people like that to come to this country?
Right, right.
There's a lot of light at the end of that tunnel, my friend.
Excellent, excellent. So with that, we move to the next phase, because a lack of time, actually immigration itself, we can talk for days together.
I know.
But it's a very good insight that you have to, all those people who are listening, talk to your Congress people, talk to your elected politicians, and put forward your what you want to do with the immigration. Because if you don't get involved in this policies and politics, then nobody's going to listen to you.
Sure.
They need to know that you are there so that they can talk. So people are ready to listen, like what Stephen Rogers is saying. So I hope you guys will go and talk to your elected people and make this through. So let's talk about how America is becoming better day by day. Your insights on that.
Well, America's coming better day by day because we have a president that's not busy apologizing to everyone around the world, like President Obama did.
That's
we have
so
a president
nice.
Who is standing very strong, keeping America first. He has won, as you just said, my friend, the economy is booming, the stock market is up, unemployment.
Yeah.
Record-breaking low numbers on unemployment in this country, especially in the minority communities around this country. Mm-hmm. Unheard of before. Opportunities through the jobs program that he put together is astounding. That's where you have the startup businesses and entrepreneurship. But he's done something that we haven't seen done since Ronald Reagan was president. He put light and hope and some a great feeling in this country. And you know, he's doing something again that Reagan did. He's diving into the spirit of the American people. When I say the American people, all of us, you, me, all of us.
Everybody in America.
Everybody in America. So in that spirit, when you talk to that spirit and you ask people to rise up and to contribute, the people rise up. And by the way, talking about rising up, when I was in Robbinsville at this at the Indian Temple there, I was astounded over how the people in that temple, when the Hurricane Sandy hit here, it was the Indian Americans in this state, in this community, as well as many others, but since I was there, this is something that we need to talk about. They gave food, water, clothing, bedding. I mean, they opened their hearts and homes to people who were very, very devastatingly affected by that hurricane. And you know what? No one looked at anybody as Indian, Hispanic.
Oh, no.
We looked at each other as Americans.
Humans.
Human beings. And we came together. That's why we're getting better every day. We have a president who's leading that charge.
Okay. You want to throw some light?
Well, I haven't seen if a man of his commitments, I haven't seen a man of his like conviction, what he has, and I'm really so much have faith in him and trust in him that the day on the first day I was in the Hilton Hotel when he gave the victory speech, because I was working for his campaign. I mean, I was not working in our community. And he said, we are going to bring back our country. We are going to make sure that this country is taken back. We'll make sure that the American people are not only feeling safe, but they prosper over a period of time. And there are countless achievements he has made. And very recently, he has avoided a world war, a nuclear world war, by having excellent diplomatic kind of relations, I mean, diplomatic kind of action he has taken with the North Korea. You know that.
We'll talk about North Korea later.
Okay. So these are the various things. Let me tell you one thing. My son, he has done his MS from Stevens University, Hoboken, and he was telling me that I was not getting the employment offers in past, in like the 2015. The offers which I am getting now, the not only offers he's getting, which are multiplied in numbers, it has been very, very they offer good benefits and good salary and everything. Why this has happened? Because the employment requirement of the corporations, because of the recent tax cuts and tax reforms, they now started hiring people. What they are doing is they are trying to reinvest their tax savings into the new projects and new machineries. And people, there are all around growth everywhere. The corporations who have saved money by the tax cuts and tax reforms, they have already given bonuses to their bonuses. The consumer confidence is so high these days.
Well, you're right. What he did was deregulation, very important, spurs business.
Bring back the tax money and then.
And I think it was Ronald Reagan who said, if you get a knock at the door and you answer it and the person says, look, I'm from the government, I'm here to help, run out your back door as fast as possible. Donald Trump took that and he says, the government shouldn't be knocking at your door. You, the people, are running this government, not the elites, not those in Congress. So the people are getting their country back, as you just said, because we have a president who's saying here. And you know what? What's great about President Trump? No more handouts. We'll give you a helping hand, but no more handouts. And people are accepting that helping hand. It's like, you know, you give a man bread every day, he'll eat it.
Yeah.
Teach him to make the bread on Monday and have bread for the rest of his life.
He has stopped lobbying. That is very important. The most of the time when people lobby to the government people and all that, I don't know, I haven't personally seen anything, but it is my pure guesswork. But I can believe when you do the lobbying, when you pay money for the fundraiser and stuff like that, you have some interest in you to get the jobs done. And the government used to take certain actions in such a way in order to make sure the lobbyists and the people for on whose behalf they were lobbying to the government, they benefit. So sometimes it may not be good for the American people.
So which leads me to this, all right? You brought up a good point. It seems like money controls everything. Mm. We created America Winning Coalition, this mm-hmm. organization that is conservative.
Yeah.
We're helping Republicans. But as I shared with one of your colleagues earlier, we don't ask for money. We don't want donations. We don't want contributions. We just want you to join us.
Amazing.
We want your talents and we want your skills to help, as you said earlier, make America great again.
Right.
By helping the president make America great again. No political party could compete with us.
Absolutely.
Because we're looking for the spirit of the soul, of the heart. And we've grown, look, our Twitter account grew from 700 to over 150,000 within 3 months. And our social media platforms are, we reached 250,000 people. So when we say to people, we want you to come on board, we're not that lobbying firm, are we?
Right.
We are out there working with the president to make America great again.
I'll share my personal experience also with regards to this IT outsourcing and other things. So when I was working in AIG around 2002, 2003, people were saying, why are you doing job here? Why not outsourcing? Mm-hmm. Why don't you outsource?
See?
After Trump came, because of the rhetoric, people are saying, why are you outsourcing this job to somewhere else? Why can't you do this here?
Absolutely.
So that's rhetoric
exactly
change.
Has happened.
Yeah.
That
has
when I was in Washington, I think maybe 2 months or 3 months before, I was surprised to see there were certain offices, lobbyist offices from different countries.
Hmm.
They go, as for example, I will not name the countries, but I have seen a couple of offices there, and those countries' people go to the government and beg for money or beg for help or beg for assistance.
AIDS, yeah.
See, this
like
is,
Pakistan does
yeah.
that
yeah,
regularly.
You put a good point again. This president has stopped all the expenses which were burdened to the taxpayers. And this president has done one more thing. He has, there are like climate change hawks, and there are different kind of hawks they were spreading. He not only stopped those payments. Now, take the example of the billions and billions of dollars are going there. Ultimately, when America needs them, nobody stands by.
Well, think about this. I was on another network a few months ago, and that topic came up about American money going to countries that are not very helpful.
Helpful,
right.
So these countries were crying the blues, and the mainstream media put pictures while I was talking of starving children. And,
I know.
And all this propaganda. So my question to the host of the show was, what gave any country
the right
the thoughts that they are entitled to American tax
money.
Dollars.
Sure, why not?
What gave any country that idea? This money is coming from the hearts of the American people and our treasury. So that's why the president put a stop to a lot of this, as you said, because America first. That was his promise, and he's keeping it.
Okay. So in the interest of time, we'll move to the next
topic. This is pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah. this is very informal, and ideally, the questions you are asking are so interesting, let me tell
Important.
You.
Thank you.
You are bringing out so many points, which is really help us to convey what we want to convey.
That's my job. Thank you.
Great job.
So moving to the next point, people say it takes two to tango. So there was some tango between Kim Jong-un and Donald Trump. First, they hated each other, someone calling him Rocket Man, that guy calling him delusional. So then it turned around, and now both are saying this guy is a lovely boy, and he's saying this guy, he's a lovely president. So what did this turnaround happen?
Well,
why
a couple
did
of things
happen?
First of all,
he is going to talk explicitly for that. I know I'm on.
First of all, President Trump wasn't going to his dance. He was coming to our dance. So that's number one. Number two, look, I learned something years ago being in the police department. When you talk to certain people, you talk on their level.
Right.
The president talked on his level. You got a button, buddy, I got one. saying that, 102 missiles going into Syria was a game changer, in my view.
Mm-hmm.
The dictator there in North Korea realized this guy means what he says. And the one thing we don't want is to give this guy, meaning President Trump, any reason to do to us what he did to Syria. So I think that President Trump simply scared the living daylights out of him. That's number one. Number two, sanctions. Sanctions are doing a lot of damage if you do any more damage to North Korea. And when it starts affecting their upper echelon, that's another thing that brings the dictator to the table. Number three, you could be sure that there was a lot of back-channeling discussions with China. I believe China, you know, had a lot to do with driving this guy to the table. Because keep in mind, the worst thing for China would be a war in Korea, because the border, the North Korean-Chinese border, would be a disaster for China. So all of this said, in a very masterful way, of course the mainstream media would disagree with us, but in a very masterful way, the President of the United States got this individual now. We won't call him Rocket Man anymore. He's been a good boy, hasn't he? He's been a good boy.
So we don't want to. He has to reciprocate to the action what he has taken.
So the President of the United States got this individual to the table where now they're going to talk. Look, you can't achieve anything without talking. The business instinct of President Trump paid off, not the political. Notice all the politicians, you know, you can't trust this guy. You can't be involved in talking to any dictator. Well, you look at a business perspective, win him over. Win him over. Talk. And that's what he's doing. And I have high hopes. I said this on a TV show this morning. They asked me, what do you think the outcome is going to be of the summit meeting in Singapore? I said, I really believe in my heart that Donald Trump is probably going to get the end of the Korean War signed officially at that meeting. At least the seeds will be planted. But this president deserves the Nobel Peace Prize even now for what he has done.
Now, let me tell you one more thing. I have seen President Trump has a very celebrity kind of charismatic personality.
He's able to. People love him.
Love him. People love. He influences the people.
I mean, he's from Brooklyn. Who doesn't love anybody from Brooklyn, New York? I'm a Brooklyn guy.
We're all Yankees now.
Yankee fans. Yeah, there we go.
I met him personally once, and I was so amazed with his personality. Come on, Mr. Bart. See, when he was clapping on my back.
President was clapping on you.
No, he was a candidate.
Candidate, okay.
I met him in the expo hall when he came here. I think Stephen knows that.
Yep.
And we organized a rally on his campaign. Mm-hmm. And I took the insurance, in fact, for that particular event. Because the insurance nobody was giving, and I given the insurance at the last moment. I talked to my underwriter, and I hold him up. I said, Hemant, it is 5 o'clock. Nobody give it. Tomorrow is the event. And the hall said they will not allow the event to happen.
So you took underwriter into confidence.
I not only took into confidence, I made sure that we have the enough liability in case something goes wrong. So I took that insurance, and he knows that.
Because without insurance, you can't do any hosting.
They will not even open the hall. They will not allow the event to happen. Okay. So I did that. And then when I met him, you know, he was so noble, so generous. Two FBI people were standing, and they were, I think, obstructing to the photo what we were to have.
This after he won the primary, you're saying?
No. He won the election as a president. Primary already won. He came here in October 2015.
Oh, okay.
In New Jersey.
Okay.
So after primary.
After primary. Only then FBI can be there.
FBI, say, maybe security, so maybe may not be FBI. So he asked these people, you know what, let me have a nice photo with this gentleman. Get the hell out of here. He's a billionaire businessman. I am nothing against him. I mean, I have no entity. But the way in which he was treating me, Stephen, that day onwards.
As equal, that's great.
I felt that this is the guy who can turn the tables.
Look what he does with police officers. Yeah. He stops and he shakes their hands. Firefighters. He stops. He thanks them for their service. So you're right. Down to earth guy.
This guy has that kind of charismatic personality, and as far as the North Korea is concerned, he has brought the pressure through China and everything. But let me tell you this: he has done this without spending a dime of the taxpayers' money. Earlier, previous administrations have spent billions and billions of dollars to these regimes, and billions and billions of dollars they have given. Now this guy has done without spending a dime. I really like it. He has brought the results without spending the money.
You know, I heard John Brennan today, former CIA director on one of the mainstream media networks, criticizing the president over the North Korean summit. This is the darkness of the mainstream media. They criticize him. They question his motives. They should be lifting up this country.
Absolutely.
They should be lifting up the president. Because at the end of the day, if the president was to fail, we all fail.
Yeah.
America
right.
failed. So we are going to make sure that we the people, are going to make sure that this president succeeds. Because then America succeeds. And who else succeeds? The whole world. Hey, look, when three Baltic state presidents were here just a month ago, you know what their common message was? Trust. We trust President Trump's judgment. We trust his character, and we trust his decision making. Now, these weren't Republicans. These were three Baltic state presidents, world leaders.
What else you need?
Yeah,
and see,
most of the time,
media is doing something. You know, when I when I read the print media, when I look at the electronic media, I was always like wondering, are they thinking about the American people or are they thinking about the outsiders who are not concerned as far as this country is concerned? Most of the media coverage is as if they are talking for them, they don't talk for our people, and that's
right.
Bad.
So on that basis, what most of the media guys are saying is like, for 15 years or more than that, we have put pressure on North Korea. But somehow North Korea was able to survive and move forward. In terms of enriching the uranium, plutonium, making plutonium bombs. So some of the reports, I cannot verify the veracity of it, but what they said is Russia and China are helping North Korea in surviving those sanctions, because you may know that Russia is also a neighbor of North Korea. And most of the goods go through via Russia to the other countries. So if we, God forsake, talks break, will we go back to the same sanctions, and what is the game plan?
Well, here's what I believe where we're headed, all right? First of all, the president has consistently said this is the result of bad deals, bad policies. We allowed North Korea under the Obama administration, the Clinton administration, we allowed North Korea to get where they are today.
Right.
Just like with the Iran deal.
Mm-hmm.
Obama, hey, you give them cold cash, you know, in the middle of the night.
$400 million by plane or cash.
So the policies of the past have gotten us where we are today with North Korea. But there is a game changer. And the game changer goes back to the one person who is not going to do business as usual, and that's President Trump. So I don't foresee it going back to the old days. And of course, look, the president has made it clear. One is he'll tighten the sanctions. Russia, they're not doing very well economically. And to be frank with you, in my view, I've studied that country. look, there's a lot of potential there, but they need us. They need us. The world needs the United States to lead.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And as I said before, the Chinese, they don't want to see a failure. Either in that region. Now, they certainly don't want to see American
winning it.
and American troops in North Korea on their border. Listen, that dictator in Russia or in North Korea may turn around and say, "Hey, maybe we ought to invite South Korean and American troops here to protect us." You know? I mean, that's really way out.
Preposterous.
I'm really joking, you know. But you never know in this world. You never know how good the president is. He'll negotiate that. Imagine you see an American flag over the North Korean capital. That's great.
He's a good negotiator.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the North Korean, the president, he has already given a sign for the success of the summit by releasing three American prisoners.
Yeah.
He laid the foundation.
And he got criticized. That's what bothers me. So the president turned around and said that was a nice thing that Kim Jong did. And he was criticized for saying he's a nice guy. Why not? Just soften the target.
Yeah.
Just soften the target.
Sure.
Let them know, we appreciate what you did.
Absolutely.
So that happened with even Bill Clinton. Like, they released three, four detainees when Bill Clinton visited
them. Of course.
Them. Yeah, that's
but
normal.
But because he's Donald Trump, you know what? Because they don't like him, they criticize everything he does. Except it's them, not the American people.
Let me tell you, whatever media is criticizing, whatever they're doing, the base, ground-based American people know the fact, and they are not being misguided at all.
Right.
They always know that what is right and what is wrong, and that is exactly how President Trump was elected.
Okay. So now if the deal goes nicely, will we pull out the troops from South Korea?
I don't think so. I don't think that will happen. I think, though, that if the deal goes nicely, there'll be a lot of talk about lowering the temperature in the region. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be great to see the DMZ go and you have a border like other countries have? I'm very optimistic. It'll take a lot of time. Trust is important.
Right.
I'm sure we don't trust them. They don't trust us. But when you have a businessman like Donald Trump there who keeps his word, you know, they may say, yeah, this guy can be trusted. So I think at the end of the day, right now it's been successful, and it's going to be up to them. Mm-hmm. They know who's coming. They know they have a president that's tough, that's strong, but fair.
Yes.
He gets that. And I'll tell you what, they may want to think about really embracing what the president's policies are. And wouldn't it be something? I mean, it would be great. I have a lot of hope that that's what's going to happen.
I'm also very optimistic, and I'm very confident that the result will be great. And number two is, he's a result-oriented man.
Man, okay.
He's going to bring the result.
So one last question on the Korea, and then we'll move to Iran.
Okay.
So this is like, okay, the deal, during the campaign, Trump has said that South Korea can build its own army, and Japan can build its own army. So is he seeing some kind of axis where South Korea, Japan build up the armies and maintain the demilitarized zone or DMZ or
The armies are always being built for defense purposes. The message that the president in this country always gets out is, look, we're not interested in occupying countries. We're not interested in taking over your governments.
Sure.
What we're interested in is democracy. Mm-hmm. So these countries have these armies to protect themselves in the event that there is a real, real serious threat. But saying that, because of what's happening with the Koreas, could you imagine that threat is really going to be reduced? Mm. That threat is going to go away. So you're going to see denuclearization. That's the president's foundation of these meetings. And it may lead to maybe a reduction of troops. The South Korean president has praised President Trump.
He asked for a Nobel Prize.
Yeah. So you can imagine some of the discussion that has been going on that we're not aware of. But at the end of the day, it'll be a more secure region. And when the world, and look, if the president of the United States is successful at this, you're going to see a ripple effect around the world. And the next stop, in my view, now this isn't any official stuff. The next stop will be the Mideast. He may be able to use those skills and talents after they see the success in Korea to finally bring peace there. Could you imagine that? No one could imagine that President Trump would be where he is now.
Right.
With all the garbage being thrown at this man, he's still done more as president of the United States in the years he's been in office than I think any president has done with regard to foreign policy. And by the way, for any doubters, he's not a four-year president. He's an eight-year president.
Eight years, of course.
So as a cue, moving to the Iran deal, your idea about it?
Okay.
Summary.
Bad deal, as he said, under the Obama administration. Paying them off, sending them millions of dollars to do what? To build IEDs that killed American troops in the Iraq war. The money never went to the people, to help the people, to help their economy. It went to their nuclear armament program. It went to their Revolutionary Guard. It went to everything. That money went to everything but where they promised it would go, number one. Number two, the deal enabled the Iranian government for a 24 to 30 day period, advance notice, we're coming to inspect. Well, look, if you had marijuana in your house and I knocked on your door and said, look, the cops are coming in 24 days, you're going to take all that drugs out of your house. You know?
And if you But don't, is it so easy to take out those things? I thought it was made with concrete and other stuff, no?
Well, there's an old saying I remember in police work. Is it so easy to break into that house that we got alarms, we got cameras? Somebody comes along and they find a way to do that.
Okay.
So
makes sense.
So
yes.
Yeah, so there's always a way to subvert the system. Mm-hmm. And interesting enough, you know, inspectors haven't been allowed to go into many of the areas that they were supposed to go
designated
into.
As the defense sites.
Yeah,
versus,
yeah,
yeah,
yeah. You know, okay. You know, so you know, you look at how the Iranians broke their word, how they consistently lie, how they have built up their nuclear arsenal. And let's put it this way. Do you trust anyone, you know, the Democrats, the liberals? Well, we got to trust the Iranians. You know, they're doing this and that. So you're telling me that as an American, I have to trust people who are chanting in the streets, death to America, death to America.
Sure.
So the fact of the matter is that the president has made it very clear, as he did with North Korea, this is the way we're going to do business from now on. You either toe the line or suffer the consequences.
So what are the consequences?
Well, the consequences, I think there are three things to look at. Number one, the Iranian people. He spoke to the Iranian people the other night. Mm-hmm. And look, there are good people there. There are very good people. So there's
most of the Iranians like American taste.
Love this country. Yeah.
They not only contain the social media, the Facebook,
exactly.
The Google,
exactly.
The Twitter. They like everybody.
So if there's going to be
they want pizza, they want beer, and all those things.
If there's going to be any regime change, it'll come from within the country. All right.
Okay.
That the people themselves.
You're will, going to empower them.
Well. You know what they're empowered like, by? Mm-hmm. They're empowered already by a president who's standing by his word, by a president who believes and articulates what democracy is, what success is. They look at the American dream and they ask, why can't this be the Iranian dream?
Sure.
And you know who's holding them back? No one but those leaders, if you want to call them leaders, those thugs in Iran. So that's number one. The second thing to look at is the sanctions. You continue to tighten the grip on Iran.
But now, sorry to interrupt
sure.
you. So previously, when the sanctions happened, you have Europe, Russia together, even half-heartedly, Russia half-heartedly, but still together enforcing those sanctions. Now, France, Germany, and Russia have said that they like the deal, and China
sure.
have said they like the deal, they don't want to go out of it. Now, how are you going to turn them around for
watch
the sanctions?
Watch France and Germany. Just watch.
Okay.
Yes.
Watch them turn, all right? And they'll turn because, you know, the president is brilliant. He left the door open, didn't he? He says, look, we can renegotiate.
Renegotiate.
So he didn't shut the door on negotiation. That was a signal to France and Germany and Iran, look, when things get really tough, you know what? That, like in military 101, we learned, give your enemy an honorable way out. All
yeah.
right? Give your opposition an honorable way out. So what the president did, it was pretty brilliant, to be frank with you. He's given everybody a way out to turn around. So at the end of the day, do you think the German people and the French people are going to trust Russia and China before they trust us? Not going to happen.
Right.
So you'll see one or two things are going to happen. Either we're going to really tighten a noose around the neck of Iran, or France and Germany are going to come our way. And then finally, of course, we never want to see military action.
Okay.
Never want to see
John that. Bolton was saying 2019 Iran. What do you say?
Let's wait and see. Let's wait and see. Right.
What is your gut feeling?
My gut feeling is that the president is going to come to an agreement, a new deal, that is going to be spectacular for the United States government and the rest of the free world. That
so military action
no
right
military
now
action.
Is not in the table?
No.
Well, everything's always on the table, but this president, you know, they try to make the president to be a warmonger. He wants to go out. Look, he hasn't fired one shot, and he's got, look, he's fired a lot of shots on Twitter.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
All right. And he's used Twitter as a weapon of mass destruction against the opposition and the enemies of this country. But he's using his skills that God given him, all right, to bring these people to the table. So our buddy there, the Ayatollah in Iran and these other people, they're going to learn real quick, just like the dictator in North Korea learned, that there's a new sheriff in town.
Yes.
His name is Donald J. Trump, President of the United States.
Awesome. So in the interest of time, we just have very few minutes.
You know,
so
you've
I
been saying in interest of time for the past
I had to jump from one
great.
Topic
this
to another
excellent.
Topic. Like
good
anything.
Job.
Good job, yeah.
So thank you, by the way. So you being an anti-terrorist squad, So what is your vision about the policies that will make Pakistan, Afghanistan terror-free? Because this directly relates to India also, right, where a lot of terrorists are trained in Islamic State. Even the Islamic State guys have been trained in Pakistan and they go there. So a lot of terrorists come trained from Pakistan to Kashmir and they create a lot of havoc. Right. As you might know, a lot of pundits have been removed from Kashmir because of that thing. Mm-hmm. And what is your suggestion? What would be your suggestion to Trump and to the world leaders of how to contain those terrorists?
First of all, to President Trump to do what he's doing. I mean, he's just about decapitated ISIS in the Mideast. Mm.
They captured five people today.
Right. Yeah, I mean, ISIS is just about gone. But also you have other terrorist organizations.
Yeah, they just sprang like mushrooms everywhere.
Yeah, exactly. So here's what we need to do, and very, very important. We have to think short-term and long-term. Short-term is our immigration policies. Every country should have these policies so they make sure that terrorists are not coming into their country, but mm-hmm. also, very important is education. They need to educate their young people in their schools now about these terrorist organizations, their ideology. Look, I've spoken to some Muslims who are horrified and appalled at how ISIS and these terrorist organizations have taken their religion and turned it into a killing machine.
Yeah.
And that's unfair to the Muslims who have worked so very hard. All their life, you know?
There are good people out there.
Yeah, yes. So the president also knows that. So my recommendation to every country leader in the world would be, not that I count, you know, but my
idea is idea.
Is to think short term and long term. Our young people today need to get an education. Build up your culture of your country. Build up your like I said, God, family, duty, honor, and country. Keep them away from all of the garbage on social media. A lot of these young people are radicalized to get involved into these countries. And here's the key. You find a lot of these young people are from divorced families, broken homes, who's out of work, and they're looking for acceptance. So the terrorist organizations, gangs too, criminal organizations, are trying to fill that gap. Look, your mom's not here, your dad's not here, you're this.
So de-alienating will make it more problematic.
Well, what?
De-alienating those people will make it more problematic.
Dealing with them?
De-alienating them.
Oh, de-alienating people from these organizations will not make it more problem. In other words, I'm saying...
No. The kids who are from these difficult families.
Oh, no. They're looking for leadership. These kids... I was a juvenile officer for many years in the police department. Uh-huh. You know, there was a young African-American kid whose father he never saw, whose mom was working hard. You know what I asked him to do? Show me his report card. You know what he did? Every day he stopped by the police department and showed me his homework.
Wow.
You see? So these young people are looking for acceptance. They're looking for family. Sure. If they don't find it in you or in me or in our leaders, they're going to find it in ISIS. They're going to find it in Al-Qaeda. They're going to find it in gangs. We can do a lot for young people. Young people, you're listening out there, you're a peer. You are a peer, and you know the kids in school, maybe who are being bullied, or the kids in school who don't have a mom or a dad. You know who they are. You know what? Don't push them away. Hug them. Embrace them. Bring them to your temple. Let them meet leaders that you know. That's how we do it.
Awesome. So if you had to suggest to Narendra Modi how India can come more closer to U.S., what would be your suggestions?
I think they're doing a great job now. I mean, how could you improve something that's working? You know how close they are? When I walk around and I go into local businesses, all right, whether it be a retail store or my doctor is Indian, you know what I'm looking at? I'm looking at somebody I could embrace. Always a smile, always respect. I've got to tell you something. Young people, young Indian Americans, the respect that they give police, elders, leaders.
Yeah.
I want to see more of that.
That's part of our culture. We just respect those
and
people.
We've lost it in this country. You know, the Europeans were all, I'm Italian, Irish American, and we've got, believe me, we've got fine young people. I'm not putting them down, but what I'm saying is that because of Democrats and liberals and progressives, a lot of people in this country have lost their way. Mm-hmm. They're no longer accountable. It's like the Tower of Babel in our Christian Bible. Mm-hmm. Everybody's babbling, and they have a right to do this, and they have a right to do that. You don't have a right to do anything until you earn it. So God, what did we say? God, family, duty, honor, country.
Okay, this is a very interesting 1 hour, and it just flew like this, and I had to jump from one topic to another, and I cannot summarize. You actually look through each one of those topics, and you write back, and you tweet it. We rest assured, we will be talking to Stephen Rogers more, and I hope you will come back to the studio.
An honor to be here. Yes. And this man here, this guy here, boy, he is good. He is working very hard for the president and for the Indian community in this country.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaste.